In this video, we'll look at the concept of quantitative easing and understand why a central bank would pursue QE. Ultimately, we'll seek out the impact on the country's money supply if QE is successful. First, let's discuss what quantitative easing, or QE, is exactly. Quantitative easing, or QE, occurs when the central bank purchases financial assets, such as government bonds and corporate bonds, from the private sector in an attempt to increase the money supply and lower the rate of interest. That's the basic definition, but let's dig a little deeper. The question we need to answer is why a central bank would pursue this and also try to understand specifically how QE works. Quantitative easing measures are used when traditional monetary policy has failed, and there are a few reasons for this. In a low or zero interest rate environment, it is very difficult to lower interest rates any further. Individuals are likely to prefer holding cash rather than put their money in low-return financial assets. This is known as the liquidity trap. To get the economy moving, the central bank can use QE to inject liquidity into the economy. If banks are reluctant to lend in times of economic uncertainty, the central bank can intervene and use QE as an emergency response to a crisis, such as a credit crisis in 2008 and COVID-19 in 2020. Again, the objective is to inject liquidity into the economic system. Having said that the aim is to inject liquidity into the economic system, what do I mean by that? Well, let's look at how QE works. Quantitative easing includes a purchase of government bonds, corporate bonds, and other financial assets from commercial banks and other financial institutions. This provides liquidity for these institutions. The focus of QE is not strictly commercial banks, but other financial institutions such as insurance companies, pension funds, hedge funds, and other investment banks. Since QE increases the demand for bonds, it will reduce their yields. Bonds are typically considered safe investments for investors, so when the yield decreases, so does their attractiveness to investors. Remember, it's not just banks and individuals that hold bonds, but the other financial institutions listed before as well. If the central bank purchases these bonds, these institutions will find themselves with more cash than before. With bonds being less attractive, they will look to invest their money elsewhere. Now, why did bonds become less attractive, and how did the yields decrease? Let's see how with an example. Suppose a government issues a 10-year bond with a face value of $10,000. It pays out a coupon of $500 per year and thus has a 5% yield. The yield is calculated as such, $500 divided by $10,000 times 100%. In this case, the coupon is equal to the percentage yield. So the coupon is 5% of $10,000, which is equal to $500. Now, if the central bank starts QE and increases the demand for 10-year bonds, then they could drive up prices of these bonds to $11,000. Now the coupon will stay the same at $500, but now the yield has changed. The yield is now 500 divided by 11,000 times 100%, which is 4.54%. As such, the bond has now become a less attractive investment. It's now returning less than it was before. If you purchase this bond, you're getting 4.54% instead of 5%. With all this activity, what's the ultimate result on the money supply? Well, an effective strategy of QE will increase the money supply because commercial banks have more reserves to lend out. Investors move funds out of bonds into assets that can provide greater rewards, such as stocks. Investment into stocks can increase their prices, creating a wealth effect. The market can view QE as a sign that the government is taking action, which in turn boosts business confidence. The overall effect will be to increase the money supply, increase lending, and increase business and consumer confidence. Effective QE helps boost the performance of the economy and limits the extent of an economic downturn. So by now, you should be able to explain what QE is, why central banks would pursue it, and how it impacts the supply of money in an economy. If you have any questions, leave them below and let's try and answer them together. That's us done for now, and I will see you in the next one.